All right, I'm going to call the meeting to order at 7:00. And can we stand for the pledge of allegiance? I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty and justice for all.
And we have an approval of the agenda for tonight.
I'll make that motion.
Thank you, Nick.
And can I throw something in? And this is completely my fault. Our policy list there is absent a couple of policies we were going to look at.
Yeah.
Those were all sent along, but with me being out on vacation, you know, a week prior, and policy meeting right before I left, I missed that we had some new policies. So Beth, totally up to the board. Those materials did come across with the policies that the committee had looked at. I just didn't get the agenda updated. It just didn't even register to me that we had new ones going on there.
That's fine.
The ones on here are for second reading. The ones we would add would be for first reading. G16, D22, E6, F4, F28. Like I said, those were ones that were included in the board packet. So that was stuff that did go out, and I just didn't even, I spaced that they weren't on the agenda, so.
And they kind of need to be approved.
Yes.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
So we should add them to the agenda.
So not policy committee's fault at all, my fault.
What were they again, Brian?
G16.
Yeah.
D22. E6.
G6?
E.
G16. D22, E as in elephant, 6.
Okay.
F4, and F28. And when we get there, we can make it real clear again, if that is agreeable to the board.
Yeah, I have someone to remember, and now I can't remember all of them.
I know. I went and I looked.
We went through a lot.
I said, oh, we've got a lot on the agenda, we're good, but there were more.
Yeah. Okay. Do we have any public input or announcement?
We have to.
Sorry.
We have to vote on that.
Oh, wait, sorry. All in favor of the amended, just with the policies added? I can't see everybody.
That's everybody.
You're unanimous.
Okay, thank you. Any public input or announcements? I don't have any.
I'm not aware of any ahead of time.
Okay. All right. So I need approval of the minutes for 6:14, which was the last board meeting, and the 7:22 special retreat that we had.
I think that should say 7:14.
Or, so yeah, 7. No.
No, 6:14. It was
it
that.
Is 6:14.
Yeah, it was that long ago.
Yeah, the one that was in Shrewsbury.
Mm-hmm. That was in June.
Yeah. Huh. Summer flies, right? Feels like a few weeks.
So yeah, so it's 6:14 and 7:22 for our retreat.
Should we? My only question would be: should we do them separate?
One at a time. Yeah.
Do you want it? Okay.
Just in case.
So do I have a motion to approve the minutes of 6:14?
So move.
I'll second.
So Len motion and Nick second.
Okay, any discussion on it? All right, all in favor?
Unanimous.
All right. And then do I have a motion to approve the minutes for the 7:22 board retreat?
I'll make a motion to approve them.
Thank you.
So Cindy motion.
Do I have a second?
Len second.
Sure, I'll second it.
All right, any discussion on that?
And I'm just saying names because not everybody can see the hand go up, I think.
Yeah, I have like split screen going on
yeah,
my computer.
Yeah.
Okay, so all in favor?
I'm going to abstain.
Okay, yes. Thank you, Nick. Okay. On to sports update.
Me. Hi, Kim and Mary, athletic director here. So just a quick little update on where we're at with some summer projects Tim and I have been doing, and our registration is open for fall. So just to give you some numbers, currently as of today, we have 391 students registered at Mill River, and we have 114 registered as today. Registration is still open, and I know many students who haven't registered yet, so we're looking at that number to improve. And if you can remember in years past when I've talked about participation going back to 2017, that was our highest at 162 students participating in the fall, but we also had close to 500 students at Mill River. So in 2022, we had 131, and I anticipate that being about the same, if not a little more, for fall athletics, which is awesome. Again, we have girls soccer 9 through 12. We will be having a JV boys soccer program here. We will have a couple still participating in member-to-member with MSJ. They'll be seniors, so they've been doing that for their 4 years. Middle school boys soccer, middle school football, varsity football, cross country, cheerleading, fall golf. And just to give you a breakdown on boy-girl, right now we have 38 girls participating in fall athletics 7 through 12 and 76 boys. We do have quite a few more boys sports for the fall, so that's why that number is a little higher. We do have 7 students from MSJ that are participating with us for football. We have a co-op with MSJ. We have 2 students from MSJ participating with our cross-country team this fall, and we are sending 2 students to MSJ for boys varsity soccer. Looking ahead at coaching positions, we still have not yet hired a varsity boys basketball coach. I still have interviews going on for that, hopefully wrapping up in the next 2 weeks. That's the plan. Some projects that buildings and grounds and athletics have been working on. We did take down the bleachers outside. If you haven't seen that, they were not safe. The last time we had inspection, there was a lot of things deemed not safe for them, and once they started getting taken down, you could see missing bolts, bent posts. It just wasn't good. So we're here to talk about some options going forward for new bleachers going in there. We've had some electrical work done. Our main scoreboard went out after the flood and didn't work, so that's being replaced. We have a basketball hoop that hasn't worked in about 2 years that we're hoping to get replaced electrically. New soccer goals have been ordered for grades 3 through 12. So 2 pairs for 3 and 4 soccer at the elementary school, a new pair for 5-6. And that's all for their practice over at the rec field at Clarendon. They'll play their games for 5-6 here at Mill River. And then we bought 2 new pairs of soccer goals for here at Mill River. So we will have 3 fields for soccer for athletes this fall to practice on. I don't know if you saw when you pulled in, there's a ton of cars here tonight. So that's kind of what it's been like this summer. Tonight we had open mat wrestling going on. We had skill session for soccer for the district students. We have cross country runners here working out. We have football here working out. Open gym for basketball is Fridays and Sundays. Summer softball used our field this summer for their games and practices. And I think that worked out pretty well for them, and it was nice to have them here. So it's just some of the things that our coaches are doing outside of their coaching seasons to get kids more involved and to grow those programs. Big picture goals, I've talked about it before, would really like to look into digital signage for out front, so we can post what's going on for the day, whether it's musical, in school, athletics. Establishing a Hall of Fame for our athletes. We have the VPA Hall of Fame that we put a banner up in the gym for those coaches and student athletes that have been inducted into that, but just more communal within our school for athletes. And you may have heard some rumblings. Track and field, we're in the very beginning process of looking into the possibility of putting in a track, not here. It's just not feasible here with a lot of other things that are going on. But that rec field over at Clarendon, we've had one company give us a print layout of kind of what that would look like. We have another company we're waiting to hear from. Liz Philscoff has been a big contributor to that and working with us with finding out grants that we can write and moving forward. So again, very early process with that. We're gonna, Brian's gonna sit down and we're gonna sit down and look at grants that we can write for that. So that's probably a five-year project we're looking at right now. Our cross-country team usually hosts a meet here in September, and we have gotten approval to host down in Wallingford at the rec park. So our track and field and cross-country coach Brian Elliott has worked with the town of Wallingford and gotten approval for that to happen. So that'll be September 23rd down at the recreational park, and there's a bunch of schools that will attend that. We have a elementary AD here for approval tonight to be hired, so I'm really looking forward to starting to work with that individual. We've got coaches we need to hire for all the teams, and just getting the work done preseason for when the elementary sports start. And then just a quick elementary update. As of today, we have 35 district students registered for 3-6 soccer. Again, we had about 80 last year, so it's just a matter of getting the email out to those principals again to send it out to the community to get them registered. Any questions?
I want to say that the rain is doing a lot for the field out there compared to last year.
Yeah.
And I play the drop-in ultimate on Thursday.
Yep.
And what's really nice is last year, really, except for like the first couple sessions, none of the high school kids came. And this year, a whole bunch of the high school kids, I think because some of them can drive now.
Yeah.
And but it's like, so that it's nice to see them doing it. And so like next year, they'll be able to play a lot better. And so it's like, and it seems like, and then I hear good things about the drop-in soccer as
well.
Yeah,
there's about
Sundays,
40 to 50 kids out there right now. And that's what it's been like on Wednesdays for the skill sessions. And then community drop-in on Sundays just for whoever wants to do that. But Tim and I have talked about, too, because we've had this nice weather, the grass is growing way faster than usual, and our contractor just comes once a week to do the fields out back. So probably starting in August, we may have to go twice a week until that starts dying back, but we're not touching our main field. We're trying to let that go about every 2 weeks and then mowing it, because that's never looked so green. I've been here 10 years. That's never looked so green. So that's just an update on like kind of where we're at with mowing and getting lines down for this fall.
So speaking of the rain, have we thought about competitive rowing?
Maybe in the Otter Creek, yeah. Sure.
More serious, is the lag in sign up typical?
So this is more than we've usually have by this time for high school.
Well, because if you do the math, it's like 29.2%.
Yeah.
And we're always
we're usually at like 32, 33.
Yeah.
So
it's typical.
Yeah, and Lynn Patrick usually sends out a blast email to all parents 7-12.
Well, I'm just thinking mine haven't signed up for fall, and I'm guilty, so.
Okay. Like I said, there's a handful that still haven't.
But I think it's great that all the fields are being used. It's actually better for them, you know, in the summertime, especially the baseball fields. It'd be nice if we could have
people
a little more baseball
it, yeah.
activity, because the grass grows in quick on the infields. Mm-hmm. So, nice to see all these cars here.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, thank you, Kim. I guess we're on to goals and assessment update.
Do you want this?
And that would be me. So I'm going to start sharing this. This is going to look similar to the update that I did last year, because our goals, technically our goals from the board have not changed. We had our retreat this past Saturday, and I will talk about that a little bit as we get through here. Question?
What? Up on the board.
Yeah. Absolutely. Oh, yeah. Len's exactly right. If you're out in digital Google land, you can't see, but we've got some notes from our retreat even up on the whiteboard in the room here. Awesome meeting, and I'm really excited, and huge thanks to Josh and Len and Cindy and Matt and Andrea and Liz. That was the group, right? Awesome thanks to that group for coming together and spending a really beautiful Saturday in this room doing that work. We have these goals, and I had committed to an update on these goals. even though we're shifting, I think, a little bit away from these goals, we're going to wrap out, we're going to finish up the year with this update. So an interesting place to kind of be, that we're in transition and moving away from some of these goals, but I'm going to give the update. I'll try and weave in a little bit about the retreat and sort of where we're thinking about going as we get through here. We do have another retreat day planned, so that work isn't done. So that's still a little bit in progress. So our first goal was student opportunities, and a lot of this work is hard to measure and is fairly ongoing work. We continue to support our students through strengthening educational support teams. As with last year, this year we also have some ESSER-funded positions that are providing our students some additional support. A new thing to talk about this year is a woodshop teacher. That was work we did during budget season and work that we shared with the community, and we brought to the community to say, can we get approval on this budget? Is adding woodshop an important thing? That, I think, is a really important pathway to give our students here in this building. Stafford runs some incredible programs. Stafford can't serve all of our students who are interested. So I think expanding some of our programs to serve those kids here in-house is a great move that the board worked on this year through budget. We also set aside $80,000 of surplus funds to improve and grow our athletics program. Kim and Tim were just here telling you a little bit of some of that work. The old bleachers that were becoming a danger are gone. That's not going to be a cheap project, but we're working on using that funding the way we said we were going to use that funding, which was field work, bleachers, and expanding elementary sports. When you look at field work and bleachers, $80,000 doesn't go very far. So really the expanding elementary work, we've been ballparking about like maybe $10,000. You know, do we buy jerseys? Do we buy, I think we bought some soccer goals, you know, things like that. So small expansion, but I think the field work that we're doing and the bleachers, the stands, I think that's important. So we are still working on improving student opportunities. We're not okay with, well, we have kids that like sports, great. We want to continue growing participation. And we know that we have to pay into what we have to support that participation. Pre-K, we haven't made large moves in a lot of years, but we're continuing to support that pre-K program. If you talk to districts in the region, we offer more hours and more support for pre-K than pretty much anybody. And that's been the case since we rolled this out, you know, 4 or so years ago. How, Jody, do you remember when the pre-K was? 4 or 5 years ago?
It was prior to 2020.
Yeah, so it's been a while, but we've been maintaining that. I think the good news, we heard Sarah Bolster, our pre-K coordinator, she shared with us last spring that we have almost no kids out anymore, because there's this universal pre-K thing where kids can go anywhere and the dollars follow kids. So they could even go to a private provider in Rutland. We don't have kids out of district in pre-K. So that, I think, says something about the quality of our offering here in-house. So good work being done on student opportunities. We retained that idea of supporting and increasing student opportunities in our board goals. We're keeping that idea that that's an important thing we need to do. We haven't decided yet what exactly that concretely looks like, but we're keeping that idea. Student growth, we're keeping too, but I think we had a really good conversation around at what point does a measure, when that measure actually turns into your target, are you still doing good work anymore? So for a lot of years in the district, our measure has been these test scores. I'll come back to graduation. I know that's the big one on the bottom there. We talked a lot about how if we're just measuring test scores and we're just trying to improve test scores, there are a lot of great ways to improve test scores. There are a lot of terrible ways to improve test scores. And we as a district want to focus on doing the good work, not just chasing the number. Because we know that if we do the good work, that the test scores will improve. So we are retaining that student growth idea, but we're going to be far more focused on what are we doing, not as much focused on, well, let's just watch the numbers. Of course, we're always going to talk about test scores. We're always going to share that information with you. We're always going to give you a presentation around how we're doing. But we want the majority of our focus to be around, okay, but what are we going to do? Literacy, we need to improve. All that wonderful LNIC work that you were hearing from our elementary teachers and from Deborah Gardner-Bosch, that's what we've been doing. We haven't been talking about test scores in district. We've been looking at what's the training our folks need? What does the current research say? How do we get that in our teachers' hands? How do we get our teachers fired up about it? How do you get a veteran teacher who goes, well, that's pretty different from what I've ever done, interested in doing that? And I think the great thing is Deborah and Jody and that curriculum team has done that work. So actually, since I'm talking about test scores, I'm going to jump back. I think a little bit of a bright spot are reading scores from fall to spring. It seems like we've been doing literacy work. At every one of our schools, our reading scores fall to spring improve. And I think that's pretty incredible. Our math is interesting because we see a little bit of an improvement. And yeah, we hang on to most of that improvement, but it doesn't carry through quite all the way through the year. We haven't been as focused on math work. We did put in place new math resources. We did not change our math curriculum, but we brought on new resources with a lot of grant funding to give our teachers things to use to support the curriculum. I think it's interesting that while we focused more on what is the funding we have, what's the best way to use it, how do we listen to our teachers about what they need, how do we get that in their hands, I was a little surprised when I looked at these test scores last week. I'm not too surprised because I know what we've done. So when I stop and I think about some of the things that we've done, and that's why I think that shift away from, well, yeah, let's have a goal that our test scores go up. Well, let's have a goal that we're going to do the things that we need to do. That we can be very transparent about. That we can be sharing with the public. And that I think we can hang our hat on way better. And then I'll show you the test scores when we're done. And we'll look and we'll see if things worked or not. If you want to see over the past couple of years, this is interesting. And you can definitely see a COVID trend here. But I think, are we rebounding enough from COVID? No. But gosh, I'm glad to see that we're starting to rebound. You know, are things perfect? No. Does math need a little more work than literacy? Looks like it. But I think we've done far more literacy work these last 2 years than we've done math work. So. I think it's hopeful, and I think it supports the conversation that we've been having at our retreat around, well, what are the things we need to do? How do we set goals and make sure that we're accomplishing them? 85% proficiency is a really long way to go. That's what we set our goals at. And actually, when you go to your teachers and you say, folks, we're going to get to 85% proficiency when our kids are at 30 or 40, that can be pretty disheartening. The conversation when you go to your teachers and you say, what do you need? What's working? What's not working? What can we do to better support you? Let's have a conversation. Let's set the path together. Let's get you what you need. Because we definitely had some tough conversations at the board level about funding some curriculum resources with grant funding. We did. And I appreciate that the board is willing to ask questions about what we're bringing forward. I think it's important to highlight, too, though, that our teachers are telling us a lot of good things, and we're really trying to listen. There are probably times where it feels like we don't listen, but we're really trying to listen. And we're trying to advocate when we see our teachers finding something that works. And I appreciate the board pushing on us to make sure that we've got our details in order, that we really have talked to our folks. That matters. I would much rather go to our staff and say, what do you need? Let's do this work together, than, hey, by the way, you need to get your kids all up to 85%. So good luck. Here we go. That's a tough way to start the year. We've been working a lot to increase data literacy. We've been sharing a lot of data early on, you know, a year and a half ago. Crazy to think. A year and a half ago, we spent a lot of time as a board kind of doing data talks every other meeting till we started getting, I think, a little bit of the hang of the conversation. Then we brought a lot of teachers to the board last year. You saw elementary teachers sharing data with you. You saw science teachers sharing data with you. So hopefully you're seeing that we're doing this work not just at one level, but that our teachers are invested in that work, and we're trying to invest you in that work too. That data literacy matters. Graduation rates, we've held reasonably high graduation rates. Our goal was 95%. We're looking at just about a 95% four-year cohort rate this past year. We were 93 the year before. So while we had a couple of rough years there, and I wonder why that was, but we did have a couple of rough graduation years, and we're holding steady with a little bit of improvement every year, which I think is good. So, those two goals, student opportunities, student growth, we talked about as a board really merging into one. Because if we're doing the work of providing opportunities, if we're doing the work of supporting that, we're doing that, and we better be doing that in a way that's causing student growth. So why are those two separate goals? So we decided to try and combine those at our retreat. Equity. A lot of this work, the board did a great job right when these goals were adopted of working on a district equity plan and adopting an equity policy. That work has been ongoing, and Jody's been presenting about that annually. We have a provision in our equity policy to annually report to the board on how that work is going. The board this year even adopted a statement of inclusion, which was not even something that was set as a specific goal, but I think something that the community brought to us. I don't know if you remember, some of you were definitely still here, but right around pandemic time, so several years back, a community member brought to us, hey, here's a sample declaration of inclusion, statement of inclusion. The community would like you to take this up. And we did that this past year, so that's great. Suspensions is really interesting. Our suspensions went up a lot this past year. You can read the national news, you can talk to your neighbors, and there is a sense that behaviors have escalated everywhere coming out of COVID. I really honestly think, though, for a handful of years, we were not addressing behaviors the way we probably should have been addressing behaviors. And again, you talk about that idea of when the measure becomes the target. What's our goal? Suspensions down. Hey, I got a really easy way for suspensions to go down. Don't suspend anybody. When the measure becomes the target, we get into dangerous territory. When we talk about what are we going to do, we're in very better territory. Because if I said to you, oh, we'll just stop suspending kids, well, you go, well, that's terrible. Let's talk about something else that we're gonna do. So I really think that idea of focusing on our goals being, what are we gonna do? What are we committing to? What's the work? I think is really important. Because we've gotta figure that out. We've gotta sit down with our admin this year and say, hey, what happened? I can tell you that in this high school building, middle school, high school, I do have a sense that behaviors were dealt with in a way that was far better than they were in the last chunk of years. I think Kaylin Thompson did a lot of really hard work this year to do the right thing. And I don't mean being on a warpath to just suspend kids. I mean, when there are expectations, holding kids to them. You know, there's a lot of work we need to do with restorative practices. But then there are also things like when a student brings tobacco on campus. There are some things that restorative practices don't necessarily work as well, and there are times when students are not interested in restorative practices either. And I think while we do the restorative practice work and how absolutely important that work is, I still think there are going to be times when we do have our progressive discipline model and we're going to follow that model. And I think in the past we didn't with really good fidelity. And I think we have. Not in a way that's looking at kids like they're criminals, but in a way that's holding them to high expectations. Because when you tell somebody, if you do this, you're going to have a detention, and they do that, and you don't give them a detention, things go downhill from there. You know, I think that's something that I'm really, really interested in our second session of strategic planning, goal setting for the board. Because we wrapped that equity piece into student opportunities and student growth too. We were looking at that as one goal, because our students who are struggling should have opportunities. So much so that they're not struggling anymore. So that looking at this restorative practices piece as a separate piece didn't make sense. Shouldn't that be a program that we offer? Shouldn't that be something that we figured out the things we need to do? And when we do those things, our students show more growth. So we looked at that all as one goal.
I ask a question.
Josh.
And I don't need the answer right now. I'd like the answer maybe at the retreat. So 47 kids seems like a decent amount of kids for the population that we have.
Yep.
If we could have, like, so when we're setting the goal, a kind of a breakdown of like a grouping of like this kind of behavior, this is what's causing the suspension, this is what's causing the suspension.
We could look at that.
If there's any kind of way that we could know that, because there's different actions for different.
Yep. For sure. We can definitely look at that.
Yep. Do we still, is that end of the year thing still done for the Department of Education?
Yes. CSRS, the Combined Incident Report.
There you go.
Yes, we still do the CSRS. Absolutely.
Because that might help too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. All those things
and
are categorized.
And I know it's a pain in the neck to do.
All those things are categorized.
Well, if we do, we look at that in our coaching meetings with principals. So I can tell you absolutely vaping is a huge issue because it's really hard to do restorative work around that. And so that tends to be a ding, ding, ding one. And that our hazing, harassment, and bullying findings are up again. And that specifically is because we did a lot of work this year in making sure that we had more people more consistently trained in the protocols, and so it's just better fidelity.
We have a lot of like vandalism type stuff here, or not much?
We had like two rounds of vandalism, one in the fall and then one in the spring, I think. No, the spring I'm thinking was vaping. Because we really just had the one in the fall, I think.
There was a rash of urinal vandalism.
And then we, you know, and again, this is the sort of thing that you go, well, you know, kids are going to be kids. When they do something, they'll be in trouble. I think Kaylin did a really good job of going, how do we solve this problem? Well, we're going to limit bathroom access to one person at a time so that there's no horseplay in the bathroom. And if one person's going in at a time and something happens, we know.
Well, they know who it was, so.
And the students were like, well, that's a pain. And it's like, well, do it for 3 weeks, and if we have no problems, we'll go back to normal. So they did it for, and I'm making up 3 weeks, maybe it was a month, maybe it was a month and a half, but I don't think it was longer than a month and a half. They went back to normal, and we didn't have problems after that. you know, because we were, it was starting to become like 4 days in a row or something. And Tim was hopping mad too, because he's going, great. Now my staff are busy trying to fix all these things, and it's just not.
There's a lot of vandalism in the bathroom that probably can't be recorded.
Yes.
You know, it's something that happens at the end of the day, and a custodian finds it at night.
Yeah.
You have no idea who does it.
Yeah.
Now, what we don't have is, our numbers are so low on peer-to-peer violent action.
Yeah,
and fights. So I'm very proud of that.
That's good.
What I will say, if there are suspensions at the elementary level, those fall under two things. Harassment, that is more than once, because we always go with education to start. Or if a student is so dysregulated and unsafe that after at least an hour, they are still a severe danger to themselves or others.
Yep.
And that is up as an issue, and we talk about the things we're going to do to work on it.
And Tim is probably talking, tell me if I'm wrong, about, you know, somebody wrote something on the wall kind of vandalism,
yeah.
too.
Or,
you know.
They take the toilet paper roll and shove it into the toilet.
Yeah.
Let the toilet overflow.
Yeah.
You're just washing the floor.
And the way we deal with some of those things is, you know, when something's written on the wall, we remove it as fast as possible. Because once, if it's there for a day, it multiplies. It's kind of crazy. So Tim and his crew do a really good job and care a lot about things looking presentable. And we know that matters. Good questions. I'm really interested in how this conversation continues as we talk about, okay, restorative justice, but what are we doing? What does that look like? That's a huge term. But what are the things we're going to do? How are we going to make sure that that work happens in a way that's meaningful? Then we'll look at the numbers. Absolutely. But I don't want our target to be suspensions go down, because then we potentially have a problem. YRBS data, the Youth Risk Behavior Survey, was another piece of this. Frustratingly, I couldn't give you this data last year because things were going so slowly getting these results back. I do have results back. So the four things we had identified, students agreeing that in their community they feel like they matter to people, having one teacher or adult in their school that they can talk to if they have a problem, students not going to school because they felt unsafe in the last 30 days, and then vaping, and current use of vaping. Interesting, vaping does look like it's gone, does look like it's gone down according to self-reported student survey. I think we are seeing more students who are realizing now that vaping's been around a little bit longer, that there are a lot of myths. And they're starting, I mean, we've even got posters up. You can walk down to the bathroom here and see one, and it's telling you, oh yeah, don't forget there's like arsenic and all these crazy things in vapes. So I think there's a chunk of the population who's starting to realize that it's not as cool of a thing as it seems like it is, and taking it seriously. Our other numbers look reasonable from previous years. These, again, are really interesting ones if we're not talking about, okay, but what are we going to do? We get this data every couple of years from this survey. And it's hard to do a ton with it and then wait a couple of years and then get the data again. So I think this is definitely good fertile ground to think a little differently about, okay, so what's our goal going to be? How are we going to do this work, if that makes sense? Community. We implemented a survey. We gave it twice last year. We had about a 35% response rate, which is, you know, seems to be industry standard. They say when you give a survey, expect about in the 30s. We looked at those as a full board in December, and we shared a little bit more. Actually, we looked in December at the results. We did a strategic planning meeting in the spring. We looked over comments. And then at our board retreat, we looked at like a summary of comments, actually. Big takeaway from the summary of comments was school safety. that that was something a lot of our families are saying that they're worried about. You know, is my child safe in school? Are they safe from external threats? Are they safe from bullying, harassment, that sort of thing? Had a great conversation at the board retreat around, okay, how do we do that work? How is that a student opportunities, student growth piece? How is that an equity piece? You know, when you talk about bullying, harassment, you know, equity definitely falls in there. Absolutely. So we gave that survey. Fantastic. We had said that we were hopeful that half of our school community was going to take that survey. 35% for the first year giving it. Good start. Not sure if that's the most important goal we have. I would rather see, again, us talk about what are we going to do? Are we using these results? Are we looking at them? Are we doing something meaningful with them? Are we really taking feedback from the community and working that into budget or policy rather than hitting a magic number? Because we could have a lot of people take the survey and not do anything good with it. So again, the measure becoming the target. We had said way back when we set these goals that 75% of respondents would show satisfaction with the district. That's, I think, a really hard thing to do in a survey, to have somebody either show satisfaction or not show satisfaction. I think unless you just ask them, are you satisfied, yes or no? So I'm not sure that that was the best target to look at. The survey we gave was so comprehensive that you could say, well, somebody was very happy with school safety, but they weren't happy with maybe academics, or maybe they were really happy with academics but unhappy with school safety. You know, well, are they satisfied then? So I think there's definitely some work to do around this community goal. We kept that as a separate goal, that we need to continue to engage the community and continue to do this work. So we have yet to bullet out what that looks like, but we definitely know that this needs to be a separate goal and we need to keep going down this road, if that makes sense. HR, we kept this as a goal too. We rephrased it a little bit to read more along the lines of, the board will continue to work to support staff. If we're continuing to work to support student opportunities, we need to continue to work to support staff too. So some things that we had said we were going to measure: retention rates. This year we had a really low turnover rate. We were really incredibly lucky. Retirements, we only had 3. Terminations, we had 4. I put a little note there, includes RIFs. So when you have a one-year grant position and the grant runs out, traditionally we would give people a letter indicating that they're a reduction in force. So while we have a grant period, we have a couple of people who, when they signed on last summer, we said, this is 1 year. Just so you know, this is 1 year. And then in the spring, we have to give them that letter saying, hey, your position's gone. We can try and secure more grant funding. We can try and have that in place. And then we can, you know, post a position, and that person would have recall rights to come back. But sometimes by the time you're able to do that, those folks go, yeah, you know, I did find a job somewhere else. So. Three of those were RIFs that were grant-funded positions. One of those was somebody who did not get their license renewed, so we could not retain them as an employee. The 9 resignations, that's not just teaching staff. I should have said that first. That's not just teaching staff. We don't have 200 teachers. That's looking at all your admin assistants, your paraeducators, your certified teachers. I even think bus drivers are in that number, believe it or not. 200 employees. Why did we go up from 195? We have grant-funded positions that we had been trying to fill with ESSER funds that we got really lucky, and we filled them all this year, where in previous years we didn't fill them all, if that makes sense. 9 people said, hey, I'm going to work elsewhere. Some of those teachers, some of those paraeducators. We always have a little bit of paraeducator turnover because that's a 10-month position, and it's not a highly paid position. So sometimes people go take summer work and they don't come back. And we kind of expect that as being part of the nature of that position. So 9 folks who said, hey, I'm not coming back. What is a good retention rate? I don't know. But that's our retention rate. Again, I would like to focus a little more on what are we doing. We're a small district. A couple of people changes a percentage point. And a couple of people could have really legitimate reasons for going. Like, oh, I want to work closer to home. Or my spouse got a job elsewhere. You know, or things like that. So I again, would like to focus on what are we doing. New teacher retention. This is an interesting year because, as I said, those reductions in force, people not coming back because they had one-year positions. Well, gosh, that really skews your data if you have people that aren't retained because you didn't even have the funding to retain them. When you hired them, you knew you couldn't retain them. So while I agree working to support new teachers is hugely important, you know, I do wonder again about this target.
It's out of our control.
Well, yeah, a little. Some of it is. Can we do great things to keep teachers? Yeah. Well, shoot, from 17, 18, and 18, 19, we've kept a lot of those folks on board, and they're still here. And it was cool to look up those names and see who those people were. We had a lot of people join the district and stick around, but you know, every year you have fluctuations.
Do you have a comments section tucked away somewhere so that if you reflect back on this in 10 years, you can go, I know why that number is askew?
No. I don't expect this to be the format we continue going forward. I think with the work that we did at the retreat, we'll see where we go. That's a good thought. To jot down some notes, but I could tell you looking at 17, 18, 18, 19, 19, 20, 20, I wasn't paying attention to any of this stuff. It wasn't my job to give you this presentation. So I actually don't know why those are the way they are. I could look at the existing people, but I don't know, it would take me hours to figure out the people that left. Because that's not easy to find data.
Uh-huh.
You know, who was hired in that year and maybe left in 2021? I don't know. Yeah. No, but that's a good thought, Nick. Noting some of those things so that there's a little more of a narrative than just a number. Because that makes more sense than just the number. Yep. Hey, when you hire fewer people too, it's harder to keep your teacher retention numbers up. But overall, I am pleased that this year we have had very little turnover. Incredibly little turnover in our certified ranks, really. We've only hired a handful of teachers this year, which is great because that's becoming harder and harder to do everywhere. Last goal, finance facilities. We continue to not have material findings in our audits. Huge thanks to Stan and the business office. They do great work. Sometimes people get a little frustrated because things get slowed down, but it's because they want to make sure ducks are in a row and we're doing the right thing. We do have a 5-year plan. So B, we have a 5-year plan. Tim was sharing it with B&G last night, and he was sharing it with B&G a month ago at the prior meeting, and we're going to share it tonight, which I think is great. That's something we can do. You know, that's not a number. That's not a target. That's good work, and I like that. We decided we need to keep this facilities goal too as part of our retreat, that this is good work that we need to continue. We talked, this last one, C, is a little bit nebulous. You know, equitable use of financial resources to provide all students opportunities for success. Well, gosh, that's your first goal, student opportunities and student growth. So we talked a little bit about how the work we do in these goals has a lot to do with funding. That woodshop opportunity, that was straight up funding. We couldn't have done that if we didn't have that go through budget. You know, so that was huge work of the board, and a great goal to put down to work towards. So that's our overview of the goals that we've had in place, with a little bit of weaving in the conversations we had at our retreat this past Saturday to really look at student goal, community goal, staff goal, facilities goal. So really four main points. What is the board going to do to support facilities, to support community, to support staff, to support students? And I think that's an incredible place to have landed after some great conversation that Saturday. Any thoughts, any comments, any questions, any feedback? I know that's a lot of information.
I think all our feedback, at the retreat, we made most of our feedback of
fair enough.
How we felt about a lot of this stuff.
Fair enough.
Which is how we got to the things that we did. And I really think, you know, student, community, faculty, and facilities are, it's a much better breakdown.
And the conversation we had too was that those aren't going away. The bullet points might change from year to year. What are we doing this year? What's our priority? What are we doing next year? What's the priority? But that we're always going to have a student goal. We're always going to have a staff goal, which I think is a great way of thinking about that. Okay.
All right. Brian, are you the five-year?
I'll throw it on the board and I'll let Tim talk. So there's our transition. We have as part of board policy that we present our five-year plan annually. And Tim's been doing great work on that. It is a board goal that we have one. So Tim, I'll let you jump in a little bit, share a little bit about B&G and sort of what was talked about with this, if you don't mind.
So we kind of have a plan for each school that we're working on. You will see some estimates up there. They're guesses. They're not dead hard estimates. It's hard to get a contractor this day and age to come in and give us an estimate for a project that may be two or three years down the road because the pricing isn't really good at that point. But like carpeting, flooring, things like that, I can get square footage costs today. So they are broad estimates, so keep that in mind. It's a living document. It was partially created before I came. I've been adding to it and updating. And I look to people, if you have any thoughts, ideas you want to add to this list. I'm not going to get everything at every school. So I'm always open for input. The little dollar signs that are out beyond are the years. That's kind of a prioritization thing. That's where I would like to see them fall in these years. Obviously, I think they're just going to be pushed out, some of them, due to funding. After meeting last night with Matt and Josh and Paul, I think our next step is to probably try to get finance or Stan or someone on board with us, because it's great, to have this list. But right now, we don't really have a plan how to fund these projects.
And some of them are not small.
Some of them are not small. And one that I touched with these guys last night, but I didn't put it on there because I don't really have a great plan. I've spoke with Brian about it. The temperatures in Vermont, things are changing. Summer school, the mold and mildew and humidity issues that are going on in our buildings are not healthy. At some point, they are going to have to be addressed, whether it's some type of ventilation, air conditioning, things like that, if we're going to use these schools in the summertime. I think, OSHA will probably, have something to say about that. I don't believe this district is the only one with this concern. I'm going to have to assume it's probably a statewide, concern that hopefully.
Because who's got AC?
Yeah.
Not many people. Not many.
Schools have AC or any other type of ventilation. The floors, as we're waxing, stripping, I was told they used to be dry. Now they're taking 3 or 4 days. And it's just slowing things down. We've actually had some mold concerns in some of the schools. We actually had some mushrooms growing in one of our schools after we shampooed. So big concern.
that people should be aware of, not on that list yet, because I have no idea of a cost. I should at least put a placeholder in there, you know, so people are aware of it. But right now, all the summer school is done at Clarendon. You know, so does that get the most attention maybe for something like this, or is there a plan to have summer school in Wallingford? Are we going to rotate? You know, those are just questions that hopefully the easy team can try to address in the near future. But there's a lot of flooring, a lot of mechanical things in there. We have a lot of aging facilities, as everyone knows. None of these buildings are new. Another thing that isn't addressed in there is the PCB testing that is kind of going on, but slowing down, I believe. Is that the way?
My understanding is during the veto session, a bill was passed that actually extended the deadline, I believe, 2 years. So while I have not heard anything from anybody specifically, my best guess would be that our schools that haven't started down the testing path, it's going to be a lot longer than we thought. You know, we had schools scheduled for fall, for spring, for next summer. Wallingford's tested. We're waiting on results.
Yep.
Clarendon's in the pipeline. I don't think they're going to stop. I think they're going to continue with Clarendon, but we still haven't heard from them that Clarendon's continuing. We just are thinking it's probably going to.
Done the phase one, what they call it. You know, they've come through and done their assessment on where they're going to put their monitors and machines to collect the samples.
Yep.
So I would assume that it will probably continue with at least Clarendon. They did tell me in Wallingford, probably could be 2 or 3, 4 months before any results come back.
Yep.
So that would be interesting, I think, just to see what they are.
Oh, yeah. You know, and every year we put on the ballot to put some amount into our building funds. You'll start to notice that when you're going 25, 50, 20, 250 a pop for some of these projects, well, we barely scratched the surface with that. You know, so there's funding to start knocking some of these projects off, but there's definitely not funding required to cover it all. You know, even in a five-year plan, if we looked at, well, let's say $250,000 a year going from unanticipated surplus into that fund, you could fund maybe half of these. Well, probably not even half. If you tallied up the estimated costs, you get about $2 million.
Yeah, I thought it was a little over that.
So maybe a third of these projects we could cover just by doing that 250 a year. So just something to be thinking about as we're setting that goal of supporting our facilities.
And my prioritization on this is just mine. You know, that's why we have the building and grounds. You know, other people can have input on this, obviously, and they may have something more important than me. So I'm always open and willing to have that conversation with someone to go down that path.
Yep.
But again, I really think at this point, I think our focus is probably trying to figure out how to finance some of these projects that need to be done.
Any questions for Tim?
I'm not going to go through every.
Yeah, every, no. Come to a B&G meeting if you want to do that. Yeah.
Two high level questions. Is it on purpose that we left the fifth year blank?
Probably just lack of updating. I do expect some of these projects to push into the outer years.
And then I know we took the paving off because of the stormwater runoff, but there's no line for stormwater runoff.
I really don't have any idea what's going to happen there. I know right now we're at an 18-month mark. And that project could come back and it could be, you're fine, you don't have to do anything. Or they could come back and say, you have to rip up from this end of your driveway right to the other side of the football field. Mm. That's how far off we are right now on either end. And again, that's right now it's state funded. The people who are working on that for us.
The plan, yeah.
With a plan. We will have a generated plan on what we will have to do towards the end of next summer.
Good
but
question.
Right now, I mean, I really, other than that, I really don't have much to say because they haven't really shared anything with us. And I have a feeling they're probably not even going to look at it till next spring.
Mm-hmm. they're probably behind a little bit too.
Did you have another question?
No, that was the two.
Does anybody else have anything?
Maybe we'll make some comments during our buildings and grounds, what we talked about, because I think it's, I just want to just reiterate that I feel like we're getting a lot of good feedback from Tim himself, from the people, from just from the school, at least in Tynmouth, I hear good things about what you're doing. So I really appreciate all the work. And I think, you know, Nat definitely agrees and Paul agrees that just getting our heads wrapped around all this stuff.
We have a lot more direction.
Yeah,
very helpful. Which is good.
Good. Good feedback. Good feedback. Awesome.
It's the truth.
Thank you, Tim. Board Education Strategic Planning is next.
Hey, this might be fast. Our next plan.
Is that all right?
Yeah, do it. Thank you.
Our next plan was August 12th.
Wow.
9 to noon. And, you know, I might recommend, what if we did either 9 to 11, and shoot me if this is a terrible idea, 9 to 11 or 10 to noon. We hit, like, right about 2 hours or so, and I feel like that was our good working time. But if you want to keep it 3 hours, I'm absolutely fine with that.
I'm good just, for 6 to 8 a.m.
Oh, yeah, right. You are.
No, you're not, Matt. You just woke up for the last one. How about we keep it booked for 9
okay.
to 12?
Leave early if we're done early.
Didn't we leave early?
We left.
Mm-hmm. We did.
Yeah. This is okay. Before 11, yeah.
Totally fine with that. Great. So I'm done. That's it.
All right. So personnel.
Hey there. Ready for this?
We got a list. We got a list.
Checking it for us.
Here we go. We did meet tonight. And we have multiple contracts to look at. They were all approved by the committee, and it was decided that we would bring these all before the board for your approval. So, first one is a contract for Lisa Barrett, educational support staff, 1.0 full-time equivalency. And I would make a motion that we accept, that we offer this contract to Lisa.
I'll second that.
Nick, you second that? Okay, thank you. Discussion? All those in favor? Okay, that's everybody. Thank you. Next, make a motion to offer a contract to Allison Coda, who 1.0 full-time equivalency, grades K through 12, working in the library.
I'll second that.
Thank you, Nick. Discussion? What did you say, Brian? Mostly Mill River?
Clarendon.
Mostly Clarendon. We'll spend a little time at Tynmouth covering the library. Okay. And Allison is currently a paraeducator who's been doing great work for us. She's qualified for her provisional, and I think is going to be a phenomenal fit for that. So she has her provisional in place, which is great news.
Okay, thank you. All those in favor? Thank you. There we go. Next is a contract for Tessa McGuire, 1.0 full-time equivalency. As an elementary school teacher, and I would make that a motion.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Cindy. It will be grade 5 at Wallingford.
Grade 5 at Wallingford. Tessa is a Mill River alum. You may know her as Tessa Davenport, but Tessa McGuire is a Mill River alum, and she's been doing Wallingford after school program for a while. So she knows some of those kids already, which is great. Just got her provisional in place, I think today, yesterday or today.
Questions? All those in favor? Okay. Next, a letter of employment as a long-term sub for Mary Holman, Math, grades 7 through 12, 1.0 full-time equivalency. This will be a substitute position through the end of November here at Mill River, and I make that a motion.
I'll second that.
Thanks, Matt. Discussion?
Mary's been working with us before, so she's not a new name, which is great that she's willing to do this long-term sub gig for us.
All those in favor? Thank you. Next, a letter of employment for a bus driver. So I make a motion that this letter of employment for Dane Tabor as a bus driver. So I'll make that a motion.
I'll second it.
Thanks, Cindy. Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Next is a contract for Rebecca Raymond as the executive administrative assistant, 1.0 full-time equivalency, and I make a motion that we offer her this contract.
I'll second that.
Discussion.
What was your position again?
Executive administrative assistant. That's
so Pam and then Ann before her.
Oh, okay.
That's why we've got Denise here.
Oh, okay.
Awesome, helping us with minutes because we had that unfilled.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. Good. Yeah. Any other questions? No. All those in favor? Thank you. Next is an employment contract for Roxanne Green as the functional behavioral skills coach, 1.0 full-time equivalency. This is a teaching position, grades K through 12. And I would make a motion that we offer this contract to Roxanne.
I'll second that.
Thank you, Nick. Any discussion?
Just so folks know, that was the grant-funded position that Phil Hall was in, and he left that position as he was hired as Wallingford principal, if that makes sense, then what that position is.
And that's still grant-funded?
Still grant-funded, yep.
All those in favor? Opposed? Okay, thank you. Next is employment contract for Deborah Gardner-Bosch, 0.4 full-time equivalency, multi-tier support system, and literacy coach. And this is a grant-funded position, and it's actually a reduction from a 1.0 full-time equivalency this past year.
Absolutely, yep.
So I make that motion.
Second.
Thanks, Bell. Discussion?
Just wondering what location.
That is going to be largely serving our elementary schools because the work that has been done in that position has been a lot of that LNIC work, the literacy work. So it's going to be covering the district, but I think a little more focus on elementary. Do you want to?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
Anything else? All those in favor? Thank you. And lastly, is a bunch of contracts for fall coaches. The vast majority of the coaches that are being offered contracts, or stipends actually, have been with us in the past. There's a couple first year folks, but they're mostly volunteers. The high school, middle school, that's volunteer as well. there is a new middle school girls soccer coach.
Yeah.
And we also have the elementary AD position. Mm-hmm. Now, rather, if folks are okay with this, rather than going through each of these individually, I would like to make a motion that we accept the list of fall high school and middle school coaches and the stipends.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Discussion? Everybody's okay?
Mm-hmm.
All those in favor? Ta-da.
Awesome.
I do have one question.
Thank you, everybody. Yep.
Was one of the employment contracts removed from the email?
Yes. Somebody last minute backed out.
Okay, because I noticed there was one that we didn't vote on tonight. That's
yeah, exactly yes. Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Good point.
All right. Just want to make sure that I think I missed.
Yeah. That would be
unusual.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. We didn't approve your contract. We forgot about you.
I just wanted to make sure.
That would not be good. No, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you. So we don't want to do that.
It's been done before.
Don't want to do that.
Thank you all.
There, I don't remember from that. What's the status of the evaluation?
Okay, I can give you a quick update. Liz, Bruce, and I sat down and took all the evaluations from the staff and board members, and we went through them each individually and compiled basically a list of things that we felt Brian was doing well and things that we might want to improve moving forward, and then future goals. Liz and Bruce and I will sit down with Brian and go over that evaluation with him, because basically the evaluation is completed. and then once we get that done, and as I spoke with Brian and the personnel committee, probably within the next week or two, when the four of us can get together and just review that. And Brian then can ask any questions and help us setting goals for moving forward, which is key. I mean, this yep. evaluation, I think, and it is the best that we've had so far. And it's one of the things, it's the main, one of the main goals of the board,
yeah,
is to evaluate the superintendent. So it's important, and I appreciate everybody's input. I think, as I say, I think it was more successful this year than it has been in the past. And part of that, I think, is because of Brian's input as well. So we'll get that to you.
Okay.
No, that's fine. Thank you. Anything else?
Next meeting.
That depends on how the next conversation goes during agenda building.
Okay.
Yeah. Maybe come back to that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Hold that thought.
Yes, I will.
Okay.
It's a secret.
Yeah.
Now I'm concerned.
To be announced.
Okay. Right.
So if Len is good, then we're going to move on to policy. And we have a good list of policies that we would like approval on to rescind as we're still doing our cleanup. Not really our cleanup, but our matching what the VSBA is doing with their policies. Do you want to go through them individually for rescind, or can we lump them?
Well, what if we start with the ones that are second reading?
Yeah.
Because those are not new. And maybe if folks are amenable to doing those all at once, I'd look at the ones for first reading individually. That would be my suggestion.
I agree.
Okay. All right. So C4. Which I can't see like my policies as I'm going here.
I'll pull those up, Andrea.
I have multiple screens going on. So I need a motion to rescind policy C4.
School visits by board members.
Yes. As the VSBA doesn't necessarily, they don't have this, so we're just still trying to match.
And then do you want to do those all together?
Yeah.
Do we want, okay.
And then
C4, C5.
And that's
so I make a motion to rescind policy C4, C5, CGR, no, C6R, D15, and E10.
And those are school visits by board members, board relations with school personnel, procedures for handling complaints of discrimination, reissuance of checks, and emergency management.
Energy management.
Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you, Josh. Energy management.
Yes.
I'll second that motion.
Any discussion?
Those were in the paper because this is up for second reading. Just so you know.
Unanimous.
Unanimous.
You're good.
We are good. Okay, so I make a motion, and you're going to have to help me on this, Brian, because I didn't write down as we were going.
Okay.
F28.
Yes.
So I make a motion to readopt F28 as we just wanted to update the dates on it.
Okay, Federal Child Nutrition Act wellness policy. So no change, just readopting. Okay.
Just re-updating the dates.
Okay. And you?
Do I have a second?
Sure.
Thank you, Lynn. Any discussion on it? Okay, all in favor? All right, so that will be updated. Make a motion. Okay, so this is going to get F3. Hold on just a second.
F4, maybe?
Mm-hmm.
And is that one of the new ones?
That we're doing back and forth. So F3 will become our F4. So we had F3 and 4 for our policies. F3 I had is fire and emergency.
Yes.
Participation drills. And F4 is access, control, and visitor maintenance. Management. And we're trying to match. So we want to make F3 to become F4 in our policy list.
So that
getting that wrong, because then I have E6.
I don't have it written in my notes. I know we changed it because it's the policies that they came with were very close to what ours already were.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Do you remember, Jody?
So I think it might just be clearer because we've rescinded certain ones to not connect and to just say F4, policy. And so just for context, that there are two new safety policies that came from the state legislature that they've requested that we adopt by August 1st. We're not going to make that deadline following our protocols, but they sent a second memo that says, or as soon as possible afterwards.
Yep. So if we just do F4 as new policy, if we need to rescind something else, we'll do that later. Okay. And this is still just first reading, so.
Yep.
Yes. Okay, so I make a motion to adopt or send F4 for a first read as that is our old F3.
Don't say that.
No, it's not. It's not our old F3. It's just, we're just saying it's our
new policy.
It's our F4.
New F4.
We're applying it as our F4.
Okay. So I make a motion to send F4 for first read.
Yeah. I'll second that.
Thank you, Ned. That took a lot. Any more discussion on it? All right, all in favor? Okay. So then I had...
Then E6 is the other one, safety, security of school facilities, but that is an existing one.
Yes.
So are we updating
what
that?
We're up,
just
We the policy that is the E6 is getting updated with the new wording that the state has sent us.
Ooh.
Okay.
Yeah, the one that's in here is not. Oh, I opened the wrong one. Open E10. Whew. I got nervous there for a second.
It's in the email. It's G16.
Our old E6 is really, really short. So the new E6 meets those requirements now through the legislature.
Right. And it is the exact wording they sent.
Yes. Yep.
Except for, fill in the blanks here.
Yeah.
Okay.
So overall, I think we just need a motion to send that for first read.
Yep.
Okay. So I make a motion to send E6 for first read.
Excellent.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Josh. Any more discussion on it? Okay, all in favor? All right, thank you. And then I had D22.
So that's records retention.
So that is a new one that has not existed.
This is developed because we have storage units that we're paying for, and we would like to not pay for them anymore.
Yeah, and we need a policy to be able to get rid of some things.
Get rid of the records.
Yep. Excellent.
So I make a motion to adopt policy D22.
I'll second that.
Thank you. All in favor? Thank you. And that. Am I missing anyone?
What's the G16 access control?
That's what the E.
That should be.
That's whatever the number that E that we
E6.
Just.
E6.
I thought I had them both as separate ones from policy.
So we actually, I had G16 was to be rescinded.
Yeah.
We
added that.
Yep.
We've actually renamed for E6.
Okay, so G16
rescind.
Yeah.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Any discussion?
And just
all in favor.
Just a reminder, E6 covers that, so it's no longer necessary. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. I think that's it.
I don't see E6 in my email.
That was all the ones that
E6
it's
is
not titled E6, but it is the E6 one. If you find
the one that's still titled G16.
There's one that just says it's the 10B, safety and security of school facilities. If you look at the document, it says E6, but the name of it didn't have E6 in it.
Oh, there it is.
Got it, Cindy?
Yeah, it says like 10B8.
Yeah. Agenda item 10B, and it's the 8th policy on there. There were so many I tried to kind of keep them organized. Holy cow.
Yeah, we might, there might be more meetings where there's lots.
I see it.
Yeah. Okay.
There'll be one.
Okay, and I have the next meeting is August 8th at 5:30.
August 8th, 5:30. Great.
And you will have another whole list.
Excellent.
We'll get right along here.
Appreciate it.
Okay. So, buildings and grounds update.
All right. So, buildings and grounds met last night with Tim.
We've really kind of hit the ground running since we started working with Tim. It's been nice. We're really trying to cover a lot of things. We spent the last two meetings really working on the five-year plan. We've been discussing the Wallingford refrigeration issue that's been going on. We've been dealing with Tynmouth with the pre-K requirements up there, also some window issues. We're kind of all over the place, but we're pulling everything together. Tim's very organized. He's very easy to work with. It's been really nice. So our next meeting is, we decided we were going to wait to have our next meeting until after the school year started, kind of wanted to let some things happen.
Yep.
Due to vacations, a few other things. Our next meeting will be Tuesday, October 3rd at 5 o'clock.
The only thing that I would comment, like from that meeting, of just the hardship that the insurance company is causing with this boiler.
Oh, man. Yes, we did talk about that as well. I forgot about that part.
If there is any other escalation that we can take in as like state, you know, agencies that are regulating the insurance, or anything else to make it so we can at least pay the people that have done work for us already?
We did do a little work with our attorney, and we were given the green light to pay for things locally, and that we would be reimbursed.
Okay,
so
good.
I think.
Awesome.
While it took far too long to get there, we got there, and Tim turned around the next day and started ordering things. So I know it's frustrating. Especially when you have two insurance companies involved, because the insurance company has an insurance company.
We did hear about that last night, yes.
Oh, boy.
I think you're throwing that in there. I forgot about that part.
Yeah.
I'm all set.
Okay. Community engagement. I don't know who would be speaking on.
I think Liz had tried to rally the troops and get a meeting together, but I think that just didn't work out. She had sent an email. But I think probably couldn't get a quorum.
I do have one question about that. Is community engagement actually considered a committee by our bylaws, or is it an ad hoc?
No.
Because I thought we added around the times we did the equity thing as well. Like, I thought that was kind of all around the same time period, and it was actually an ad hoc.
I think we formalized it.
Did we formalize it? Okay,
It may have started. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm checking it. No, it is. It is actually in. Yeah.
Okay. So maybe we did formalize it.
I think you're exactly right that it started as an ad hoc.
Okay.
When we did reorg, we were going to try and combine it with something, but we noticed that it was its own standalone committee.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. All right.
No. Good question. Good question.
Has negotiations met?
Negotiations has not met. We had to cancel the meeting. That sort of falls on me. I didn't do my homework before vacations. So I need to send out a email to the committee members and try to figure out a date in early August that we can get this ball rolling again, but I'll let everybody know.
Yeah, and if we meet in August, we're in totally great shape if we meet in August. We just need to touch base before
year
starts. Yeah.
So I'll keep everyone on the loop on that.
On to finance, thank you, Brian, for filling it in.
Unless somebody else really wants to jump in and do pay orders, I will read the pay orders. I'm going to start with a 713 pay order, because actually there was one while we were not meeting that we haven't gotten signed. So 713-2023, general fund, the amount of $287,807.27. An additional general fund amount of $54,263.15, and then a final general fund amount of $4,306.77. Those are all from fiscal year 23. Then we have a general fund fiscal year 24 for the amount of $4,156.84. That total on this order right here is $350,534.03. So I would look for a motion to approve that pay order as read. Oh, I can't make a motion.
Oh, I'll make that motion.
Matt will make the motion.
I'll make the motion.
Okay. I'll second it.
Okay. All seconds.
You're right.
I doubt it.
Nope, all good. Discussion?
We also probably should vote for me to sign these at the end because Andrew's not present.
Thank you, thank you.
I can actually do it tomorrow, Matt.
Okay.
All right. Okay.
Because I can download and I'll give it back to Karen.
Okay. That's fine.
All in favor? Then we've got today's pay warrants. So I will start with payroll. We've got a regular payment for FY23 of $2,272,185.77. Another regular for FY23 of $14,507.03. Another regular payment of $29,189.07, and a final one for fiscal year 23 of $8,813.21. Then we have some payroll warrants from FY24, the first of which is $6,808.38, $123,687.18, $22,521.16, $4,007.02, $13,985.55, $124,789.79, and $46,609.73. So grand total of $2,667,103.89. So a motion to accept that payroll warrant as read?
I will make a motion as read by Brian.
I'll second.
Discussion? All in favor? Unanimous. Okay, and then I've got from the general fund, FY23, $113,461.80, and then $238.26. Then from FY24, the total there is $113,700.06. Then from FY24, I've got $319,310.61. Activities I have from Mill River, $3,003.06. From Clarendon, $578.34. From Shrewsbury, $959.56. From Tynmouth, $941.16. And from Wallingford, $792.79. For a total from student activities of $6,274.91. So I would ask for a motion to approve as read.
Make a motion to approve as read.
Cindy's got a motion.
Second.
Second by Paul. Discussion? All in favor? Okay, unanimous. I don't know if Liz sent, we've got a finance meeting scheduled. It's a bit out. Let me pull it up on the calendar and just remind folks, because summer becomes...
Yeah, you didn't tell me.
Yeah, summer's quiet period a little bit for finance. We have a meeting for August 31st at 4 p.m. on the calendar. 8:31, 4 p.m.
And I'll let her know that if that needs to change or anything, just send an email.
Okay, great.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Transact other legal business. So I have a question under that one.
Yep.
Can I make a motion for Matt to sign all pay warrants and contracts tonight?
You can do pay warrants. I wouldn't worry about contracts. We do contracts through our system. So we do that a little differently now.
Okay, so I don't need to have him sign anybody that we just approved tonight?
No, I just do the warrants.
Okay.
Good question.
Well, then I make a motion for Matt to sign all pay warrants tonight on behalf of me not being present.
I'll second that.
Thank you, Nick.
Thank you, Nick. All in favor? Okay. Thanks, Matt.
I do have two items for transact other legal business. apologize for squeezing these in. I don't like doing that. We've got two pieces coming from Buildings and Grounds. Tim and Kim had talked a little bit about the field work and some of that. You know, we have that $80,000 that was set aside to do that work. I think there was a little misunderstanding where folks were going, oh, well, that $80,000 came from the board, right? So it's been approved for use already. Well, no, if we spend $15,000, we still need to go to the board for items that are, even if it's something we've been talking about for months and months and months, mm-hmm. you know, we still need to bring it to the board. That's still our board policy. Vermont bid law and statute is actually $40,000, which is really interesting, but our board policy is $15,000. So these are coming to you really last minute because of that. So we said, whoa, 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 we got to bring these to the board. Yep. So that's why they're here and not as an agenda item, but transact other legal business. The first one's called bid one, if you see that, bid one. That was for bleachers. You'll notice that all but one offer powder coating. We feel that the powder coating is going to help them last a lot longer and look a lot nicer. So we are recommending that the board go with the least expensive of the powder coated from Stadium Systems.
And so one's going to be red and one's going to be blue.
Yep.
So metal?
Yep.
Ah.
So I'd ask for a motion to that effect.
I'll make a motion to that effect.
To the wording.
Yeah, that we accept the bid from Stadium Systems.
For $16,388.
Second. Discussion?
In comparison to the one that was just taken down,
yep.
Seating-wise, comparable or bigger?
No, they will not be as large, no
Tim,
way.
I think Tim said around 100.
It's 100 seats.
Yeah.
Yeah,
which I
don't know what the old one is. Maybe that's tight.
I bet you could at least do 150 on the old ones. I think the old
not
ones.
Not that you wanted to, you're safety.
No, and I think part of the challenge really is the cost on these is pretty darn high. So with the $80,000 and thinking about the fields and the bleachers and, you know, they didn't want to spend all their money just on bleachers.
I think it was like to get the same style was like,
$100,000. Does that mean we look at this again in the future? I'm just thinking those bleachers are packed every time we go to a game.
I think with this you can add additional bleachers down the road if you choose to.
Yeah, Tim did say that. Yeah, Tim did say last night that there was space to add on, and he would be able to add on in a year or two if we had more funding.
And they're gonna pull these will be like closer to the bank. There'll be more space between them and the field as well.
So
is the plan to pour when they pour the pad.
Good questions. Other questions? Okay. All in favor?
So do we have a let's vote?
Yeah, there's a motion out there in a second.
Okay. So all in favor of adopting these? All right. Perfect.
Okay.
Unanimous? And can we... I don't know if Matt has addressed this, but it was brought to my attention. We need to get payment to the person that took down the old bleachers.
Oh, I wonder if payment's on the way, huh?
It was just brought to my attention last weekend, so if that's something we can check into.
I'll ask Tim, yeah.
Okay.
Sometimes things take longer than folks expect just because of the time it gets approval and a check cut and all that stuff, but I will double check with Tim on that tomorrow, first thing.
Okay, thank you.
Yep, bid two. I don't know, did I give you?
There's two of the cuts.
It's the same as the
duplicate. Oh no.
Exactly the same.
Yeah, that's absolutely my fault. Sorry about that. I do have bids from Tim that I can show you if you're comfortable with it. Absolutely, it's up to you.
Sure. I'm fine with it.
For the... Let me find that real quick. And I'll put it up on the screen for you. For the grounds work, actually.
Okay.
to... Okay, great. Let me share this. Sorry, I apologize for wasting your time doing that and not having that ready for you. Okay. So Tim had also been working with Kim to try and set up the groundwork to upgrade baseball softball fields. They reached out to three different contractors to solicit bids, and it was actually pretty darn challenging to get much back from anybody. Fabian, we had been talking with Fabian, you know, months and months and months back. When we were proposing to put this on the budget, on the ballot, we worked with Fabian to try and get like a ballpark from them, like, hey, how much do you think some of this stuff would cost? When it came down to it, Fabian said, we just can't do it, and they didn't submit a bid. Diamond Turf submitted a bid, but only for partial work that Tim was asking for, and they had no availability even until 2023. Thomas Field Solutions provided a bid for $23,955, and they can schedule the work and do the work. And that's all the work that Tim and Kim were looking for. So recommendation from Tim is to contract with Thomas Field Solutions due to availability, and I would say the ability to actually do all the work we're looking for. I think that matters a lot. So. We would ask for a motion from the board to approve entering into a contract with Thomas Field Solutions, Matt Thomas, for $23,955 for work to upgrade our baseball and softball fields.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
Thank you. Any questions?
Yes.
Yep.
So is this updating the middle school softball field as well?
I do not know that. I do not know that. My guess is it's everything that's not our football field.
Okay.
Because our football field is the one that we have challenges working on because of our wellhead. I can send a firm answer to the
board
tomorrow.
I would just be curious because I had thought there was discussion about that being worked on like right in the beginning of this past season,
okay.
And nothing got done, and I was just kind of a little like...
So the question is really, are the middle school fields being addressed too?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'll ask and I'll get that to
you. You can't play
board.
On that. It's unsafe. Okay. So that really needs updating.
And I know Josh has brought it up in the past. What is the longevity and the forward looking to maintain this?
I think.
And if you can't answer it, that's fine too.
Yeah. I think we are likely going to be coming back and talking about running costs during budget season. I think it's not going to be $80,000 added to the budget every year, but I think as we look at this, you know, I wonder if a running cost of about $10,000 added, you know, something. When you look at an athletics budget, that's somewhat substantial. When you look at our district budget, that's not even a cent on your property taxes. So I think finding a reasonable running cost to maintain some of these things is going to be important.
Yeah, because I'd hate to redo all these fields and then 3 years go, where'd that money go?
Yeah, we live on a dirt road and our neighbors, we all chip in and we pay for the dirt road, and it's like, we can either get it done the right way, then maintain it, or we can just let it go and it's gonna cost you, you know? So I agree.
Well,
that's
the perfect example. I have a very long driveway and I maintain it twice a year for that reason.
Yeah, but once you do the really good work, you can let it slide and do the really good work in another 5 years, or you can maintain a little bit every year. So I think there's gonna be a conversation in budget season around what that maintenance cost looks like.
Okay.
No, good question. Very good question. You know, would it be this every year? I don't think so. This is a lot of makeup work to get things in reasonable shape. Good questions. Any other questions?
All right, so we need to vote on it. All in favor? All right, I guess we're good.
No, it wasn't
Nick.
No,
yeah.
We wasn't unanimous.
Oh, it wasn't? Okay, I can't see.
Sorry.
No, that's fine.
All opposed?
That would be me.
Okay. Oh, now I can. Okay.
Yep, sorry, I still have that up there.
That's okay. So, did everybody vote?
Yes, everybody voted.
Okay. All right, well, it's passed. So we'll let Tim know and then get that update about the middle school field.
Yep, absolutely.
Okay, agenda building 4. Speaking of that, I'm going to talk about it in this part. So I had a thought in looking at calendar. Our next meeting would actually be scheduled for next week if we wanted to keep the first and the third on our schedule. My idea is for August to do our next meeting August 9th. And then we have one on the 23rd, and then in September, we'll go back to doing it the first and third Wednesday of the month. So I guess bottom line, I'm saying that our next board meeting instead of next week would be August 9th.
And I think Andrea has a great idea, because I really want us to get back on schedule. I don't know what I would bring you next week. You know, to have a meeting next week.
I already have it in my calendar that way.
Oh, how about that?
I know, Nick.
We kind of talked about skipping it.
But is everybody okay with getting back on first and third in September?
I think that's a great idea.
Okay.
And that, and we're still, you know, kind of in the summer, everybody's pushing for vacations and stuff. We could even have a light agenda for the night.
Yep.
Or something.
Yep.
So then that brings Len into the factor in him having a personnel meeting on the 9th.
At 6:30.
6:30 on the 9th.
At 6:30 before the board meeting on that 7th.
Okay.
Okay.
August 9th, 6:30, personnel. Awesome.
And don't forget the retreat.
August 12th,
the retreat. I think for agenda building for the 9th, actually, I think might be a light meeting. I would propose we spend some good time looking at our yearly meeting schedule and have that conversation around how did that work? Do we want to do it the same way? Do we want to do it differently? Because we made a pretty big shift last year in how we scheduled our meetings and what we, the folks we asked to come to our meetings. So I would like to look at.
Can we look at our traveling too through the winter?
Yes.
We're gonna have to after that in there.
And for that part, I don't think we would have the response by the next meeting, but asking each school to be like, we will gladly come and do 2 visits.
Yeah.
Is that actually what you
would
like? You
want to
do
2 visits, yeah.
Yeah.
Or are they happy with 1? Yeah. I can do that in the meantime, and let's have that conversation on the 9th. I don't really have anything else I'd recommend for the 9th. There might be something that would pop up, but I think...
Well, policy is going to be heavy.
Yeah, policy and personnel. Just in case, we'll maybe have a position or two to fill before we start the year. So I think for policy and for personnel and that conversation, hey, if we get done at 8:15, I don't think anybody will be too upset. Is that reasonable?
Works for me.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Awesome.
Do we need an executive session?
None I'm aware of.
All right. A meeting adjourned at 8:48.
Awesome. Thank you, everybody. Have a good night.
Bye.